In this video, you'll learn how to add wall jumping and sliding to your games. This will drastically increase the fun that your players can have by allowing them to fly through your levels without a care in the world. This method of wall sliding is extremely fluid and flexible, allowing you a great amount of control over the end result. Howdy, and welcome to Game Endeavor, where you can learn practical dev skills from an experienced developer. Wall jumping is an absolute favorite of mine in platforming games. There's endless joy to be had in the ability to bounce off of walls and use the terrain to get around. In this tutorial, we'll take a look at how you can easily implement wall jumping into your game. To keep the code from becoming a confusing mess of spaghetti code, we'll be using a simple state machine to determine whether or not we're wall sliding. The same code applies without a state machine, you will just need to use a lot more if conditions to piece everything together. I made a quick tutorial on how to implement a really simple state machine if you would prefer to go that route, which I highly recommend. There's a link in the description and an iCard in the corner. Let's go ahead and get started. Before we start wall sliding, we first need to be able to determine if there is a valid wall next to us that we should start sliding on. Godot has a built-in way to check and see if we're on a wall. However, it requires a constant force to be applied against the wall, which isn't going to work for us here. Instead, we're going to use raycast. Specifically, I'm going to use two raycasts on each side. And these raycasts are going to be kept in their own Node2Ds for each side. This is important because we're also going to want to know which side of the wall is to our player. I have already cached these variables inside of an onReady var named leftWallRayCast and rightWallRayCast respectively. To check these raycasts, we're going to create a method in our player script named checkIsValidWall. This will take a property wallRayCast as a parameter, which is going to refer to the Node2Ds that hold these raycasts we mentioned earlier. We'll create a for loop to iterate through the raycast, checking for raycasts in wallRayCast.getChildren. For each of these raycasts, we will check to see if it is colliding by checking if raycast.isColliding. We could stop here and return true, but some of you may want to put your raycast closer to the floor or have longer rays. If you do this, then you could have situations where the raycast collides with the slope, which will cause it to return true. Instead, what we'll want to do is check to see if the slope is steep enough to be considered a wall or not. To do this, we're going to use the dot product to measure the slope. I can go into more detail about dot product in a future video if enough people are interested. Let me know if that is something you would like to see in the comments below. But essentially, dot product will measure the angle of one vector 2 relative to another. Our raycast will return a normal of the wall, which we can use to check with our floor normal to get the angle of the slope. We'll create a variable named dot, which we'll set to vector 2.up, dot dot, raycast.getCollisionNormal. Vector 2 being our floor normal, and the raycast normal being the wall's normal. This will return a value from negative 1 to 1, 0 being a vector 2 perpendicular to our floor normal, negative 1 being in the opposite direction. Personally, I prefer to work in radians when dealing with angles, so we can convert this to a radian value by wrapping the dot product inside of an acos function. Now that we have this, we want to check to see how steep it is, which we can do by checking if dot is greater than pi times 0.35. This would be a little more than a 60 degree slope. You may also have slopes that go in the other direction, and we don't want the player wall jumping off of these, so we'll add an AND condition that dot is less than pi times 0.55. If this is true, then we should return true. If this loop completes without returning, then we know that no valid wall was found, so we can return false. Now that we can check our wall raycast, we need to use this to determine which direction we should start wall sliding in. We'll create a method named updateWallDirection, which we'll be using to determine which direction the wall is relative to our player. We want to create a variable named isNearWallLeft and set it equal to checkIsValidWall leftWallRayCast. And also for the right wall, we'll set isNearWallRight equal to checkValidWall rightWallRayCasts. These values hold whether we're on a valid wall or not, but we need to process them into an integer so that we can quickly tell which direction the wall is. So much like we did when getting our move direction in the player controller video, we'll define a variable named wall direction at the top of our script and default it to 1. Then back in our method, we're going to set the wall direction equal to the negative int value of isNearWallLeft plus the int value of isNearWallRight. However, this will make it so that if the raycast detect a wall on both sides of the player, then no wall will be detected, which you can imagine will be frustrating for the player. So we'll make an else condition, and then we'll create an if statement before this, checking to see if isNearWallLeft and isNearWallRight. This will handle the case where the wall is to the left of the player and to the right of the player. If true, then we'll set wall direction equal to move direction so that the player can choose their wall. Move direction is a variable that we've set in our move input method, which is -1 if we've pressed the left input and 1 if we press the right input. Now that we have our wall direction, we're ready to start fiddling around in the player state machine. First things first, we're adding a new state, so we'll go to our ready method and add a state for wall slide. Now we need to call the method parent.updateWallDirection in the state logic method of our player state machine. This will ensure that the wall direction actually gets updated. When we're wall jumping, we actually don't want to process any horizontal move logic, otherwise we could walk off of the wall. So we're going to put the handle input method inside of an if condition, checking to see if our state is not equal to states.wallSlide. However, we're setting our move direction inside of the handle input method. You'll recall that our updateWallDirection method needs move direction to be updated. So we'll sneak back over to our player script and remove the line that sets our move direction, and we'll place it inside of its own method named updateMoveDirection. We'll return to our state machine and call this method inside of our state logic method just before we update the wall direction. Now we're ready to start transitioning to our wall sliding state. We only want to transition to it if we're either jumping or falling. So in our getTransition method, we'll make if conditions in these states checking if parent.wallDirection is not equal to 0. If so, then we should wall slide, so we'll return states.wallSlide. With this, we're now able to get into the wall sliding state. However, you probably wouldn't know it had I not told you, and that's because we're not doing anything once we enter the state. So we'll go down to our interstate method where we're processing the logic when we step into a state, and we'll create a condition for wall sliding. Inside of this condition, we want to call our animation player and tell it to play the wall slide animation. However, we're still face planting the wall, so we also want to say parent.body.scale.x equals negative parent.wallDirection. Body is a cached node 2D on my player that holds all the visible elements for it. This will make it so that we're facing away from the wall during the wall slide. Some of you may notice, however, that this is more wall than it is slide. That's because the gravity is still being applied normally. We want to limit our gravity so that we can only fall so fast. We're going to create an if condition in our state logic method checking to see if our state is equal to states.wallSlide, because we only want to cap our gravity in this state. Then we'll call the method parent.capGravityWallSlide, which we'll go ahead and create inside of our player script. This is a pretty simple method. We're just going to set velocity.y to a max velocity. However, in some wall jumping games, you may have the ability to slide down faster if you hold the down key. So we'll create a variable named maxVelocity, which we'll set to our normal wall slide velocity. I will use 96, which is the most pixels we will fall per second. 96 happens to be my tile size, so my player will fall 1 tile per second. We'll make this a ternary statement by adding if not input dot isActionPressedDown else 6 times 96, which will make it so that max velocity will be 96 if we're not pressing down, else max velocity will be 576, or 6 tiles per second in my game. Then we'll say velocity.y equals the minimum value between velocity.y and max gravity, which will make it so that we maintain our regular velocity if we haven't gone over max velocity, else we'll limit our speed. Now is around the time we'll probably want to start implementing the actual wall jumping. For this, we want to define what happens when we wall jump, so we'll define a method named wall jump in our player script. We're going to want to define how much velocity we apply for our wall jump, so at the top of our script, we'll create a constant named wall jump velocity. We want this to be a vector 2 that is up and to the right, so I will set mine as a vector 2 of 800 and negative 1000. Fun fact for those of you that want precise control in your wall jumping, the kinematic equation used in my video on setting jump height actually applies here as well. Now we'll return to our wall jump method and create a variable wall jump velocity in lowercase, and we'll set this to the constant wall jump velocity. We will then multiply the x value of the wall jump velocity variable by the inverse of our wall direction. This will make it so that the x value will point away from the wall, which will cause us to jump away from it. And with that sorted, all we need to do is set our velocity equal to wall jump velocity. We can now return to our state machine, and inside of the input method, we'll add a condition checking if our state is equal to states.wallSlide. And then we'll check to see if we've pressed the jump input by checking if event.isActionPressedJump. If so, then we want to perform the wall jump, so we'll call parent.wallJump to do the jump. Then we'll set our state to states.jump. Something you may notice depending on your settings is that sometimes when you try to leave the wall, be it through jumping or falling, which is something we'll do later in the video, you may get put into the wall slide state again. This is because we've transitioned to the jump or fall state, and now we're detecting the wall is near us again, which throws us back into the wall slide state. To get around this, we're going to add a tiny cooldown after we leave the wall slide state so that we can enter it again. For this, we need to add a timer to our player scene. I will name mine Wall Slide Cooldown. Make sure that you enable one shot, and we can adjust the time to something smaller, such as 0.2 seconds. Then I'm going to cache it inside of the player script so that it's easier to reference. We want to start this timer whenever we exit the wall slide state, so we'll return to our state machine and go into our exit state method. We'll need to add a match statement and check for our old state property. We'll add a condition for states.wallslide, and then we'll call parent.wallslidecooldown.start inside of the condition. To ensure that we don't enter the state when the timer is running, we'll modify our jump and fall transitions by adding parent.wallslidecooldown.isStopped to our wallslide conditions. And now we're officially wall jumping. However, you'll notice that other than actually jumping off of the wall, there's no other conditions causing us to leave the wall sliding state, which means that if we fall to the floor, then we will remain in the wall sliding state, and we can continue sliding down invisible walls. This means we need to add a couple of transitions. So we'll go into our getTransition method and create a condition for states.wallslide. First, we'll check if parent.isOnFloor to see if we've landed. And if so, then we'll return states.idle. Then we'll check to see if parent.wallDirection equals 0, meaning that we're no longer near a wall to slide down. In that case, we'll return states.fall. Another thing you'll notice is that if we jump off of the wall, regardless of what we set wall jump velocity to, we will quickly slow down. This is especially noticeable if you release the move input. This is because we're lerping our x velocity towards our move speeds times the move directions during the jump and fall state. To fix this, we're going to go to our getHweight method, which we call when we're lerping our x velocity, and we'll make this a little smarter. We want to return our normal weight when we're grounded, so we'll add an if condition checking if is on floor. If so, then we'll return 0.2. Else, we're in the air, and we have a few other conditions to consider. First, we'll say if move direction equals 0, then we'll return a tiny weight of 0.02. This will make it so that if we jump without any movement, then we will come to a stop eventually, but it won't be as sudden. Play with this variable and find what works for you, as it will have a drastic impact on the feel of your platformer. Else, we'll check to see if move direction equals the sine value of our x velocity, meaning we're pressing our input in the direction that we're moving. And if the absolute value of velocity.x is greater than our move speed, meaning we're moving faster than our maximum running speed, then we want to return a weight of 0. This will have the effect of not slowing us down at all. This is really fun when wall jumping and will give you a nice airborne effect. Think of Super Meat Boy, where you can jump really far across the entire level. I don't have my velocity set that high, but it still has a really nice effect. Else, we want to return a value of 0.1, which is where nothing else applies, so we're either trying to move in the opposite direction or we're moving in the same direction as our input, but we're not moving fast enough, in which case we want to increase our movement speed up towards our max speed. Another thing you will likely notice is that if you try to move away from the wall during a wall slide, you're pretty much stuck and will be forced to jump if you want a quick exit. This isn't always ideal for the player. Usually they expect to fall off of the wall when trying to move away from it. However, if you were to implement that, then you would quickly notice that your wall jumping becomes highly unresponsive. This is because you're no longer in the wall sliding state, which means you cannot wall jump. To fix this, we need to implement some stickiness for the wall. So we'll create a timer and set it to a small amount of wait time, such as 0.2. and enable one shot. Then we want to connect its timeout signal to our state machine. This will be called when we want to force ourselves out of the wall sliding state. So we'll check if state is equal to states.wallslide. Then we'll set our state to states.fall. But of course, we haven't implemented this timer yet. So first we'll cache our timer into a variable named wallSlideStickyTimer. And then we'll create a method in our player script named handleWallSlideSticking. And we'll check to see if move direction does not equal 0, and move direction does not equal wall direction, meaning we are actively trying to move away from the wall. Then we'll start our wall slide sticky timer. However, we only want to start this timer if it currently isn't running, otherwise we will reset the timer. So we'll add an if condition checking to see if wall slide sticky timer is stopped. If the player were to release their controls or start pressing input towards the wall again, then we would want to cancel trying to leave the wall, so else will stay wall slide sticky timer stop, which will stop the timer from forcing the player off of the wall. And then to use this logic, we'll call it inside of our state machine. In the state logic method, inside of our if condition, checking to see if our state is wall sliding. If you followed along with the camera improvements tutorial, then you'll notice that it doesn't quite follow the player well when they're on the wall. This camera system isn't really meant for wall jumping platformers and will need some revisions for it to work properly. I haven't designed this yet, but we'll try looking into it in the future, and maybe make another video on this. We now have wall jumping in our game, and if you would like to learn more practical dev skills, then watch this video here. And if you're new, then join the sub club to get notified for future videos.